This is your story. This is my story. But most of all, this is the greatest story ever told. This is God's story. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God had put on my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went through the valley gate toward the jackal well and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on towards the fountain gate and the king's pool. There was not enough room for my mount to get through, so I went up to the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or the nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. And then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in? Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king had said to me. And they replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work.
The Old Testament comes to an end with three building projects. There's the rebuilding of the temple under the leadership of Zerubbabel. God once again has a place to stay. Sacrifices are once again being made for sins. There's the rebuilding of the wall around the city of Jerusalem under Nehemiah's leadership. There is now protection from the many folks who have bullied them over the years. But the most important rebuilding project going on is the rebuilding of the lives of God's people. What happens next is not Zerubbabel's idea, not Nehemiah's idea, or even Ezra the priest's idea. It was the people's idea. They are initiating their own restoration with God, and this is the way it should be. They all gathered together at the water gate, all the men, women, and children. They told Ezra to bring out the book of the law of Moses. It had been 140 years since they heard anyone read God's word to them. They were truly hungry. They had been through a lot. They had been rightfully disciplined by God and now ready to listen. The story tells us that they were sitting on the edge of their seat. Ezra is going to read the entire book of the law. You may remember that Joshua did this after the sin of Achan. This spiritual experience serves to refocus, to recenter, to remind Israel of what is important. It aids in the rebuilding program of a life aligned to God's upper story. This has been our goal as we have gone through this story together, that God would refocus, recenter, remind, and rebuild our lives on what is important, His upper story. Here is how it unfolded. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Hebrew word for amen literally means so be it. What a different attitude from the days of the kings. The story continues. The Levites instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. The Levites, those who served in the temple, formed small groups throughout the large crowd, making sure the people understood what was being read. You know, the Bible is sometimes hard to understand. We need others to help us to make sure we all get the message of God. That's been our second goal through the story experience, to set up the whole church, the whole family, to go through the experience so we can help each other understand it. You know, that's what makes small groups so great. We are told next that the people began to weep, not just little tears, but all out weeping. Why? Because They were hearing God's word, his love, his desire to be with them, his promise, his plan to get them back, and they were no doubt overwhelmed with regret and joy at the same time. Nehemiah, the governor, had to step in and comfort them. He told them that this was a holy day. He called them to go back home and to celebrate, to share a meal together. Why? The story simply says, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. The same emotion comes upon people today as they finally get what the Bible is all about. The Bible is not 100 ancient, unrelated paintings, but a mural all knitted together to tell of God's great love for us and the extent he will go to get us back. It is overwhelming when your soul finally gets this message, often resulting in tears of joy. But it doesn't stop there. As they were reading the law, they found things that they weren't doing. They didn't, as James tells us in the New Testament, want to be mere hearers of the word. They wanted to be doers of the word. So they found in the law that they were supposed to be observing this holiday called the Feast of Tabernacles, and they got after it. So much so, we are told, from the days of Joshua until that day, the Israelites had not celebrated it like this, and their joy was very great. You know, obeying God's word, aligning our lives to his plan, brings joy to our life like nothing else. The same is true for us. You may have missed it. I certainly did when I first read it. But the only thing they didn't reinstate is a king. This was never God's perfect idea, but he allowed it. And while there were a few good kings, for the most part, they led the people astray. The people are now not asking for a king. Been there, done that. The last person to speak before the Old Testament comes to a close is Malachi. He tells us that the next prophet who's going to speak for God is going to actually introduce us to the one we have been waiting for, the one who will provide the once and for all solution to getting us back to God. He's going to introduce you to the Messiah. And this is how he says it. I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant, whom you desire, will come, says the Lord Almighty. Who is this messenger that he's talking about? Anybody got a clue? When we turn to the first pages of the New Testament, we know he's talking about John the Baptist. Matthew tells us in chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, in those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Isaiah also foretold of the role of John the Baptist in Isaiah 40 and verse 3, and now Malachi, right before the close of the Old Testament, restates it. Malachi says that the next time God speaks, which will be 400 years from now, it'll be through the lips of John the Baptist. He is going to prepare the way for Christ to come. What does it mean to prepare the way for the Lord? It isn't just an announcement. It is a call to prepare our hearts to recognize him for who he is and to receive him. I hope you've enjoyed our journey through the Old Testament. It is filled with stories of adventure, of love, of heartbreak, of triumph, of power, of disappointment, of struggle, and the list goes on. But remember, it isn't a bunch of unrelated stories. Each story we have encountered has contributed to the unfolding of the one story of God. In chapter 1 of the story, God revealed his vision to create the lower story and then to come down and to do life with us in a beautiful garden. But the first people didn't embrace that vision and they were escorted from the garden. We learned that their choice is transmitted to all of us. We are carriers of the sin virus that keeps us separated from God. We also learned through the story of Noah that the solution to getting us back into a relationship with God is not going to be found in us. It must come from another. The rest of the story of the Bible is all about God's promise and plan to provide a way for us to come back to God, for each of us to have an opportunity to overturn Adam's choice and to make our own. Every single story we have read about Israel, from chapter 2 to chapter 21, has been pointing to the first coming of Christ, the Messiah. I've tried to show you how it all comes together to lead us to Him. I've tried to show you the clues that God has left along the way. Now, as we turn the page, it's finally time for us to meet this one we've been waiting for, our Savior. Like the children of Israel, we need to prepare for the way of the Lord. We need to prepare our hearts to receive this one who is going to give us back our intended life and destiny with God. Are you ready to meet Him? Then do what the Israelites did in this story. Stand to your feet, lift your hands to the heavens, and shout, "Amen, amen, so be it, so be it."